Hello everyone, my name is Nadia Kuchta. I'm currently a postdoctoral researcher at the University of Washington in Seattle. However, today I'm going to present to you the work which I did during my previous employment at Durham University in the UK. For more than 10 years, I have been working in the field of organic semiconductors, and I particularly enjoy working with emissive organic semiconductors. Therefore, my today's work is dedicated to a special case of emissive organic semiconductors bearing room temperature phosphorescence and thermally activated delayed fluorescence phenomena. Fluorescent organic semiconductors can find their applications in organic light emitting diodes, or OLED in short, which moved rapidly from the lab benches to industry. Then go sensors, biorecognition, and as we all are concerned about privacy, security inks, and anti-counterfeiting. For example, organic light emitting diodes are multi-layered devices consisting of two substrates, two electrodes, hole and electron injecting and blocking layers, and the emissive layer on the development of which my work is focused. The materials for anti-counterfeiting and security inks tend to utilize a little bit more complicated properties such as afterglow and stimuli response. Here you can see the requirements to the emissive compounds. First of all, this is stability, means thermal and electrochemical stability, the emission color controlled by the wavelength, and most importantly, the emission intensity. However, fluorescent emitters tend to utilize only singlet states, and that leads to only 25% internal efficiency in the OLEDs. The question is, why not to utilize triplets then? Charge recombination in organic light emitting diodes gives 25% of singlets and 75% of triplets. Triplets are generally non-emissive at room temperature. The utilization of heavy metals such as iridium and platinum induce mixing of singlet and triplet states by spin-orbit coupling. However, this kind of complexes tend to be unstable and the metals are expensive and toxic. In turn, TADF tends to harvest triplet states by reversing their system crossing, thus leading to 100% efficiency. Currently, there are two ways of triplet harvesting on the peak of research. This is room temperature phosphorescence and thermally activated delayed fluorescence. TADF upconverts triplet energy to singlets, thus leading to the enhanced emission from singlet states. That finds applications in organic light emitting diodes, sensors, and bioimaging. On the other hand, RTP utilizes the emission from usually non-radiated triplets. And here I should say that it is quite uncommon to observe room temperature phosphorescence, as the majority of organic compounds tend to exhibit their phosphorescence only in rigid media and at low temperatures. Thus, the applications of RTP are bioimaging and security inks. And while these two processes are quite fundamentally different, the materials share quite a surprisingly similar design. Speaking about the molecular design, rules for the TADF emitters have been polished throughout the years. However, here you can see one of the most common molecular designs utilizing rigid donor, rigid acceptor linked covalently by the nitrogen-carbon bond. We have to ensure a tiny rocking of the donor acceptor to have the radiative decay. Also, donor and acceptor units have to be balanced and their HOMO and LUMA have to be separated, though showing a tiny overlap to ensure good optical properties. Also, we are looking for a small delta AST to enable an efficient risk from triplet to singlet state and high fluorescence quantum yield. Key signatures of the TADF process include the charge transfer nature of emission, the ratio of delayed fluorescence to prompt fluorescence increases at higher temperatures, the addition of oxygen tends to quench triplets, and most importantly, we are looking for the linear dependence of delayed emission with laser power to distinguish from the triplet-triplet annihilation process. Current challenges include understanding the complex interplay of steric effects, small singlet-triplet energy gap, charge transfer state, vibronic DA coupling, then also looking and designing for new structures, enhancing the OLED efficiency and color purity, and trying to increase the rate of reverse intersystem crossing. So how is RTP different? In terms of the molecular design, we are still looking for the orthogonally linked donor and acceptor structure. However, we want to incorporate the hetero atoms to favor internal system crossing, because this is what exactly leads to the RTP emission. Also, we are looking for the rigid triplet first triplet state with a hybrid pi bind and pi character, and preferably one conformation of the molecule in both ground and excited states. Here you can see the advantages of RTP, such as tunability by molecular design, thermal and electrochemical stability, and practical applications can be enabled by casting from solution, gel, and processing from solid powders and crystals. Current challenges are similar to those of TADF, such as understanding the complex interplay of steric effects, also increasing the phosphorescence lifetime, and looking for blue phosphorescence. Therefore, in this work, I want to show to you how by simple modification of the molecular design, it is possible to ensure efficient TADF and also increase the efficiency of RTP. As we remember, the main requirements for TADF and RTP emitters include perpendicular donor-acceptor architecture, decoupled donor and acceptor, and sufficient charge transfer character. However, if we take a small donor such as carbazole and link it orthogonally to the acceptor, we will not be able to ensure orthogonal orientation, because the donor does not provide sufficient steric hindrance and it would rotate freely around the donor-acceptor bond. That would lead to the lack of charge transfer character and cancel TADF in this case. Therefore, to ensure strong charge transfer, we tend to utilize six-membered ring donors such as phenethiazine and acridine. While those enable stronger charge transfer character, they might also lead to the observation of various radiative and non-radiative pathways. For example, as you can see here, linking phenethiazine donors orthogonally to the plane of the acceptor leads to TADF in a so-called equatorial conformer, while attaching the donor in one plane to the acceptor leads to the axial conformer, which shows RTP and no TADF. Therefore, in this work, we have designed and prepared three materials, bearing taxanthin acceptor and phenethiazine donors. We have attached bulky terbutyl groups to ensure steric hindrance and to lock the compounds in solely one conformations. We wanted to get equatorial conformation. And we have linked the phenethiazine donors in meta and orto positions to the sulfur of the acceptor. Additionally, by swapping the terbutyl by the bulkier electron-accepting benzoyl group, we were able to enable TADF in this molecule. To check whether we are ending up having stable equatorial conformations as we wanted, we ran ground state DFT calculations, and here you can see the energy scans proving to you the stability of the equatorial conformer. Thus, we can see that the a barrier needed to twist the molecule by a certain degree, for example, like 20, 40, 60 degrees angle, is quite high. This is a direct proof of the stability of the equatorial conformation, which is the highest in the benzyl substituted compound. Further on, we proceeded with computing the first singlet state properties. And the main takeaway message from this slide is good separation of HOMO and LUMO in the benzoyl substituted compound, which we are looking for the TADF material, and a little bit larger charge transfer character in the orto substituted terbutylated material. Here we can see the singlet and triplet energy diagram of these compounds, and as expected, both terbutylated compounds show a moderately large singlet triplet gap and a tiny gap between first singlet state and TN, such as T3, T4, and T5, which is needed to ensure stronger spin-orbit coupling and observe RTP. As expected, benzoyl-substituted material shows a tiny gap both between S1 and T1 and S1-DN, which might be favorable for TADF. So what happens in the triplet state? Well, this slide looks quite different to the first singlet state. The main takeaway message from here is that, surprisingly, the acceptor of the meta-substituted terbutylated material tends to tilt in this T1 state. thus leading to interrupted conjugation and to higher triplet energy. And we are going to see how it affects our photophysical properties. Here you can see steady state photophysical properties of the compounds, and unsurprisingly, both terbutylated isomeric compounds show very similar absorption fluorescence and phosphorescence with a moderately large S1 and T1 gap. And the third benzyl substituted compound has almost isoenergetic fluorescence and phosphorescence. We have looked a little bit more in detail into the RTP properties of the terbutylated materials, and not only were we able to uncover the emission wavelengths, so both of them are green RTP emitters, but by studying the emission intensity in the degassed conditions, we were able to find out that the emission intensity of the orthosubstituted material is a lot higher than that of the metasubstituted material. And the phosphorescence lifetime of this compound is 3 times longer than that of its isomer. So why is that? We have attributed that to the more rigid T1 skeleton of this compound, unlike the tilted and less conjugated skeleton of the metasubstituted material, and concluded that a certain degree of charge transfer is necessary for the observation of efficient RDP. Here you can see in turn the TADF properties of the metasubstituted material, and not only can we see the increase of the overall emission in the degassed conditions, but also we can clearly see 3 regions in the decay curves, such as prompt fluorescence, delayed fluorescence, and phosphorescence, with the delayed fluorescence increasing with temperature, which is a characteristic of TADF. Also, the very fact that we can see delayed emission at 80 Kelvin proves that we have very efficient TADF. Linear fit of the delayed fluorescence dependence on the laser power fluence is a direct proof of the thermally activated nature of this compound. So therefore, to conclude this work, not only we were able by molecular design to lock our molecules in solely one equatorial conformation, but also we were able to contribute to the existing design rules of this molecule. Thus, for the efficient RDP emitters, we are looking preferably for a singular conformation and a rigid geometry in the T1 state with a certain degree of charge transfer. While for the efficient TADF compounds, it is useful to use the carbonyl group to promote the reverse intersystem crossing and rigid skeleton. Thank you for your attention.